Welcome to the Royal Swedish Academy of Engineering Sciences, IVA, and this kickoff of our new project, Roadmap for Metals and Minerals. My name is Tuula Teeri, and I'm the president of IVA. IVA is, like we like to say, the first academy of engineering in the world. So for over 100 years, we have contributed science-based advice on major societal challenges, in particular energy, sustainability, and competitiveness. We have seen many, many industrial and societal transitions over the past years that IVA has existed. And one major transition is happening here right now, a transition to a fossil-free society that is both urgent and inevitable. So one key aspect of this transition is the rapidly increasing demand for metals and minerals. It is needed for electric cars, wind turbines, solar cells, and other fossil-free technologies. So we will today discuss the challenges that we face, both from global and regional perspectives, and introduce our project now that is called exactly Roadmap for Metals and Minerals. So once again, a warm welcome to everyone, especially our international guests. Thank you for flying to Sweden, to Stockholm, to share your experiences and your knowledge with us. I wish you all a very successful day with metals and minerals. And I would now like to hand over to our moderator, Erika Ingvall. Varsågod.
Thank you so much, Tuula. And thanks for welcoming us and for IVA to host this really important project. So I'm Erika Ingvall. I'm usually with the Geological Survey of Sweden, but today I'm doing this moderator thing for this project. And I could tell you that the survey is the hottest government agency in Sweden nowadays, according to our minister who visited us Tuesday. So today I'm going to guide you through this program, the matter of securing supply for the green transition, for digitalization, for society as a whole. And it's global and geopolitical context we're doing this in. And I'm going to start with introducing the project to you. And then we're going to move on and look at fellow countries from and getting the view from the Commission and from the US. And then we'll round off with a very distinguished panel discussing the challenges faced on a local level when it comes to Sweden's possibilities to contribute. So now I would like to welcome to the stage Elizabeth. I can't think of anyone more qualified to lead this project than you. You're a mining engineer, and you have had a number of leading positions. And now you're running this, and you have still, even though you say you're retired, you work more than ever. So I'll hand you over to introduce the project.
Thank you very much. And I think it's time to change pitch here. Yes.
Maybe here.
Yes. Okay.
Okay, sorry, it went to one extra. Good.
It's a great honor and a pleasure also to be chairperson for this very interesting and right today an extremely important project. And we all understand, especially people in this room, that the transition that we're going on now to have a combat climate change, to change the society more environmental, climate friendly way, it needs more of minerals and metals. And we also have the new Raw Material Act presented yesterday or the day before it came. I don't know what it was, it because of our project or else, but I think they were a little bit ahead of us. And Sweden and Europe, we have great possibilities in this transition. And especially Sweden as a mining country can really contribute in many ways. And when we started this project, what can a new project contribute with? And we said, and we have to find new solutions, and therefore we have gathered a very competent steering group and other people in this project, around 70 people. And we will look at, in many ways, how can we contribute to the supply of important minerals and metals for the society in Sweden and for Europe. And in Sweden we have a big mining industry and big mineral industry, and I think we can contribute with many interesting insights. And we would like to have a very interesting dialogue with different groups and from different parts of society, because that's very important to solve the problems we have ahead. So, next picture. When you should make or build a project within IVA, you have to have supporters, you have to have a dialogue interest group, and we have to have funding. And if you look at this site, you have many important companies like LKAB, Epiroc, Swedish Mining Innovation, Vinnova as an authority, ABB, Sandvik, Stiftelsen Strategisk Forskning, Zinkgruvan Mining, Ramsells, and Mistra. And they are all supporting our project. The steering group, I'm the chairperson. We have an international reference group with Per Storm and Magnus Eriksson as chairs, and a political reference group, and that's very traditional in the IVA project, to meet parliamentarians to discuss different issues, to have this political context, because they can really put things forward to make things happen. With the working group Extraction with Kerstin Konradsson, working group Circular Flows with Mikael Dahlgren, and then the working group Politics and Politic Acceptance with Gert Nilsson. So thank you for... Ska jag gå tillbaka nu? Sådär.
And Kerstin, Mikael and Gert could also enter the scene and introduce themselves. This is that? Yes, yes.
So maybe first I'll ask you a question, Elizabeth. Now you told us about the main issues of the project, but how do you think we can contribute and solve the challenges?
I think we have to put them on the table, and with the people that are involved in this project. There are people from the business sector, from small companies, big companies, from the research, from universities, from financing authorities, from organizations that are supporting the mining industry, for example. And we have former politicians in our group and other persons. And with this broad knowledge, I think we can identify the very different issues that we have to handle and have to discuss in the project to give suggestions how to go ahead to be even better in this field.
Thank you so much. And now it's time for our working group chairs to talk a little bit of each of the parts of the program. So I would like to introduce you to Kerstin Konradsson to start. And you are the chair of the Extraction and Supply of Metals and Minerals Group.
Yes.
So, Go ahead.
Go ahead. No, well, just briefly, my background is more than 30 years in the metal and mining industry, both in Sweden but also outside Sweden. I'm the chair for this group we call Extraction. We have put together a team of experts covering the entire value chain from exploration, mining, smelting, and refining. We also have experts that covers areas that actually goes across the value chain, like sustainability or geopolitics. We end up also in quite deep discussions regarding competence. And we have started now by combining all these expertise we have in the team to work us through the value chain step by step, with the target to identify the gaps, but also the sort of potential solutions in order to reach the overall target of this very important project, and that is to create a sustainable supply chain, the entire value chain, I would like to emphasize, for the critical metals and minerals.
So, do you think that the group can contribute to an increased access to more metals in Europe?
Well, not as such or physically, but I think what we could really contribute with is to increase the knowledge and understanding, first of all within our team and the companies, but also for all the stakeholders and the important decision makers, so we can create a common platform. And from that, I really hope that we will be able to take the right decisions needed in order to make things happen for real.
Thank you so much. Looking forward to the results from your group. And now over to Mikael Dahlgren. Yeah. You're chairing the expert group looking at circular flows.
Yes, I must say I'm extremely happy. We have gathered some of the best experts in this area in Sweden. Extremely good, I would say, going from recycling technology, circular business model, but also the policy instruments. And we are attacking the problem from a circular perspective, that we take each areas of the circular flow, going from the design to how do you produce the goods, and how do you actually, how the usage of them, and then coming back, how do you do end life of cycle, and how do you retake it, and then get it in as a sort of a secondary metal again into it. But we also will look on the deposit of that. And I think we will have a lot of nice discussion. We already started, we will analyze it, and we already come up with conclusion that looks quite interesting. But then at the end, we will then combine it to a nice report and communicate it.
Looking forward to that too, and then I want to see some action. So, and Gert, welcome. Gert Nilsson, you are the chair of the expert group looking at politics and public acceptance.
That's correct. And I think there's no secret to anybody that mining and mineral extraction is surrounded by many opinions and quite a number of conflicting goals. You have a variety of opinions. How should we do this? Is this sustainable? Is this the future, important for the future or not? And we have assembled a group of experts that try to illuminate those issues from as many angles as possible. I think the aim, and we will also invite other people as we move forward. What we aim at is to go beyond positions and understand why do you take the position? What is at the core of the matter? And by going from kind of wide position to what really matters, we could also find paths forward that, you know, that respect all the different interests, but still lead us to the target. And that's really the ambition, to find the path that will make what Mikael and Kerstin are trying to do, with public acceptance, to say that this will work. Maybe not to everybody's. Maybe not everybody will be pleased, but at least everybody will hopefully accept what we're doing.
So you really think that the group can contribute to solving the problems, or are you more looking to showing the pathway, the way forward, and on how the rest of us can work with the challenges?
No guarantees, but what we have heard so far, I think there already at the first meeting there was a lot of important information, and I think, as I say, I think if you wipe away all the position taking and all the negotiations and come down to what is really important, what is really the heart of the matter, I think down there is actually paths forward, and I'm convinced that we will find them. Mm.
Thank you so much to you, and I want to wish you good luck forward, and I hope we'll reconvene here at some time to hear the results, and maybe some time on the way to sort of give you more input, because today is about giving the project a lot of input, I think. So thank you so much to you, and now it's my pleasure to welcome on the scene our State Secretary to the Minister. Of energy, business, and industry, Sara Modig. Welcome, Sara.
Thank you.
I guess you come loaded with a lot of impressions from Canada and PDAC.
Yes, I do.
So it was really good to have you here.
Thank you so much. I had the possibility to attend at PDAC two full days last week. It's like a long time ago, but it was only last week. But we had a really good time, and I got to meet, got a lot of impressions. I got to meet a lot of international colleagues as well, which was great. And thank you for inviting me. And I was telling my colleague before that EVA is the place where I've been visited the most since I started my position in end of October. Feels like that I'm here once a month, which probably means that you do a lot of good things that brings me here. But ladies and gentlemen and dear participants, it's a great honor for me to participate here with you today at the Royal Swedish Academy of Engineering Science and the launch of EVA's new project, Roadmap for Metals and Minerals. The main question for the project is how Sweden and Europe can secure sustainable access to essential metals and minerals for the green transition. This topic is urgent, and in view of Sweden and Europe's need to ensure sustainable and robust supply chain. Many raw materials have shown to be irreplaceable components of numerous green and emerging technologies and essential industrial developments such as renewable energy system, electrical vehicles, and rechargeable batteries. This includes not only critical minerals, but also metals such as iron and copper. The world is facing a transition towards a low-carbon society, and the mining industry plays an important role in supplying raw materials needed for this transition. It is important to ensure a secure and sustainable supply of raw materials and move away from today's dependency on a few countries when it comes to critical minerals. Sweden has a long history of mining and metal refining, and the mining industry remains important to Sweden. Sweden also has a strong exploration potential for the most of the metals used in new technologies, and we also have the potential to mine these sustainably. We have also a strong collaboration between mining companies, technology equipment companies, and academia and research institutes, and we believe that global innovation cooperation is necessary for the development of a sustainable and competitive mining
you
business.
You are the only participant in the conference.
Someone joined us, huh? The project presented here today is an example of such collaboration within the innovative mining cluster. More efficient and more predictable environmental permitting processes for environmental and climate improving investments in combination with continued high environmental requirements can benefit the mineral industry and lead to a faster green transition. This is a priority issue for Sweden. Unfortunately, I will not be able to attend the entire day today and listen about the Raw Materials Act today during this seminar, but the Critical Raw Materials Act is file that is has priority for the Swedish presidency of the European Union, as we are a leading mining nation within the EU. And the file has potential to be an important tool for EU's competitiveness and resilience. Given the huge demand of raw materials, we as the presidency, we work to ensure a balanced and proportionate act that facilitates the supply of raw materials from both primary and secondary sources and takes national conditions into consideration. This includes action focusing on increased EU production, but also on resource efficiency, circularity, and diversify global trade, because we will need that all. So thank you so much, and I wish you all the best for a successful event today.
Thank you so much, Sarah, and of course you're welcome to stay as long as you can. And I hope you come back again, of course. So now to the next point of business today. I'd like to introduce Peter Handley.
Already?
Where is he? There you are. You've had busy times this week and last week. Last week you were in Toronto and PDAC and started talking about the content of the new act. And yesterday we had the release, and now all the documents are out there. So it's exciting time for all of us, and I would like to welcome you to the floor and tell us more about this.
Thank you very much, Erica, and thank you very much to the IVA for inviting me to come here. So yesterday, as you've said, the Commission presented the European Critical Raw Materials Act, and now the Critical Raw Materials Act is on tour, and this is my first gig. As it should be, it's with the country that's holding the Council presidency, so it's going to be very important to get the co-decision process with Parliament and Council off to a very good start, starting with the presentation which we'll be doing to the Council Working Party on Industry on Monday. And in parallel, we'll be going to present it to the European Parliament as well. Do I have some slides somewhere?
You should have. Emily?
Super, there we go. Yeah, I'm going to talk mainly about the regulation. So the package is a big one, so I don't expect everyone to have read every word. For those of you of a less comprehensive disposition, there is a short press release, there is a fact sheet, there is even an infographic, so I suggest you start there. But the full Monty is a communication which explains what we're doing, why we're doing it, and which also announces a number of actions which are not legislative in nature, and I'll come on to those. The second big element is a proposal for a European regulation, the first ever piece of European legislation dedicated to the security of supply of critical raw materials. This is backed up by a thorough impact assessment, which on the second time of asking got a positive opinion from the Regulatory Scrutiny Board. There's also a very thorough piece of work produced with us by the Joint Research Centre, which is a foresight study on 15 technology and applications covering green, digital, defence and aerospace, and looking in particular at what raw materials go into those and where there are likely to be the most problems in terms of balancing supply and demand on a 2030-2050 perspective. And then there's also the critical raw materials list update 2023, which is backed up by a criticality report and a series of fact sheets on each individual material that we've screened. We've screened 85 materials, basically most of the periodic table. Right, so let's get into it. Yeah, there's a lot of stuff on this slide, but essentially, The reason we're acting is, as we already heard from the previous speakers, because Europe has decided it wants to be getting to climate neutrality by 2050, and this means a massive transition away from fossil fuels in our economy to cleaner forms of energy, cleaner forms of industry, and changing our consumption behavior patterns as well. Now, on top of that, we have a digital strategy and a digital goals. You'll have seen our CHIPS Act a year ago. So we really want to get much more control over the whole digitalization of the economy. And the new element, which has really come up to be equally important with those other two, is defense and aerospace. I mean, at the moment, it's obvious. Just earlier this week, my commissioner was in Bulgaria looking at how we can ramp up the production of ammunition for the Ukrainians, right? So this whole supply of metals and minerals for the green, the digital, defense, and aerospace is what's driving us. And we see from this, I could have picked any graph, there is an expectation that demand globally and demand in Europe for many of these metals and minerals will rise sharply in the coming decades, and there's going to be a very fierce competition for access to these resources. Our Foresight report gives us the number of a 12-fold increase in European demand for lithium by 2030. And the problem is not that we import. We do import a lot of metals and minerals. The problem is it's over-concentrated. So we saw what happened when we had a less than 50% import dependence on Russia for natural gas. Look at the impacts that had. And yet, with many metals and minerals, we are over 90% dependent on a single source of supply, which is generally, but not always, China. It can be Turkey. It can be lesser numbers, like around 70% for platinum group metals for South Africa, 65% approximately for cobalt from the Democratic Republic of Congo. So you see it's a value chain problem. If you look at the rare earths and permanent magnets here, classic example, it's not that China controls the world's ores, but many of the ores a channel towards China for the processing, refining, and production of permanent magnets. And that's the problem we face, supply side concentration. And we know that this can be a problem for various reasons. There can be supply chain disruption, and we have to become much more resilient as an economy. Right, so the purpose of our legislation is to ensure a secure and sustainable supply of critical raw materials for the Union. And it's got four building blocks. So strengthening all parts of the value chain, external diversification, better risk assessment, risk mitigation through monitoring and similar actions. And then the fourth building block is circularity, resource efficiency, sustainability. Now, getting into these, we start off, the very first article of the Act is defining that objective of secure and sustainable supply, and then saying, well, how do we measure success? And measuring success is set in terms of benchmarks, which are on the right-hand side here, where we're seeking to improve our domestic capability in terms of our consumption. So we should try to extract at least 10% of our consumption needs with domestic resources, where we have those resources and where we can get those resources operational within this time frame. There's a good important caveat there. The second is we should develop and maintain and not lose our processing and refining capacity in the middle of the value chain. And thirdly, we should develop our capacity to recover and recycle these raw materials. It may look like a small number to you, but you have to bear in mind that whereas we're approximately 40-50% recycling rate for things like copper and aluminium and steel, that's not the case for many of these niche critical raw materials, which can be 1% or less. So we've got a lot of ground to make up. The other way we measure success is diversification of supply. What the article says on this is we should be trying to source from several countries and not to have more than 65% of our consumption coming from a single country. That's going to be a tough one to deliver. Now, what we also do, the next provision is defining and limiting the perimeter of action. So there's a broader perimeter of action, which is the criticality exercise with which you're probably all familiar. And we've updated the assessment and gone from 30 to 34 materials on that list. And that is for the whole economy. So what we need is a sharper focus on the things which correspond to our green digital defense priorities. So it's technology positive, not technology neutral. And we've come up with a list of 16 what we call strategic raw materials, where there will be stronger incentives and stronger obligations set out in our legislative proposal. Now, the first pillar is strengthening the value chain. And what you don't see on this slide, I think, is very important, because we have put in a provision about exploration. We are asking all member states to develop an exploration program to look at the potential they have in their subsoil for the decades to come. And we're saying, look wide in terms of the type of materials, because who knows what's going to be important decades down the road. Technology requirements change. And look deeper, because by and large, in Europe, the geological knowledge is 30 years out of date, and it doesn't go deeper than 200 meters. I know this is probably not true for Sweden. The next thing we say on strengthening the value chain is, let's try and achieve our domestic capability and our diversification goals through identifying strategic projects inside Europe and outside at the different points in the value chain, mining or extraction, refining and recycling. We will have a process to identify these projects. They will have to show that they're helping to meet our headline objectives, that they tick the boxes in terms of environment, social, and governance. They're technically doable. They have cross-border benefits and social benefits in the case of third countries. And also, we'll be looking at the financial bankability of these projects. The consequence for projects in Europe of being listed as a strategic project are, firstly, on the permitting side, we are proposing to streamline the permitting process for mining and for the refining, recycling types of project. The big difference between an industrial facility on the one side and a greenfield mine on the other. The key thing is, this is the classic thing that all member states are aware we need to do. We need to have a common way of approaching permitting, whether it's for renewable energy, net zero industries, or critical raw material projects. One-stop shop, project coordinator to make sure things don't get stuck, some deadlines, predictability built into the system. Also taking a look at encouraging you to make sure that if things get referred by appeal to the courts, there is a prioritization so they don't get stuck in the courts for several years either. And also making sure that the environmental impact assessments are done, but you know, more effectively. So there's a lot of predictability built in here, and we'll see how this goes in discussion in the Council and Parliament. The second benefit is on the financing. There is no new dedicated investment fund in this proposal, unlike the CHIPS Act. What we are proposing is a blending mechanism where we look at the projects that we've identified to see how we can best de-risk them through attracting in private investment, national money and European money. And there's also, I should say, not mentioned specifically in our proposal, there's been this spring a lot of change to the state aid rules, which now also allow state aid along the whole critical raw materials value chain. Yes, we will also be incentivizing offtake agreements, including pooling the needs of many companies to develop an offtake at scale, which may make the difference between making a project bankable or not. So on the risk monitoring and mitigation, we want to bring together the best expertise around Europe. And here we have, for example, Peter from DERA. We have to make sure all these agencies around Europe can work together in the way that gives the best analysis and intelligence possible, so we can look at the risks, we can do stress testing, we can give advisory messages to governments and companies. We will also look into the potential need for strategic stockpiling and information sharing about this. There will also be provisions which would allow governments to collectively use public procurement to secure critical raw materials if necessary. But this is only at the end of a long range of options. The final thing to mention about this is we are asking governments to identify which companies over 500 employees are producing the strategic technologies for green, digital and defence aerospace purposes. And those companies should do a regular two-yearly audit of their security of supply vulnerabilities, risk assessment, risk mitigation, which they should then report to their own company board, not to the government, not to the European Commission. So it's about making companies aware and more ready to invest in their own resilience. And governments are free to provide incentives to companies that do the right thing. Then we come to the chapter on circularity and sustainability. We have a list of things we encourage member states to do to promote the recovery and recycling of critical raw materials. We put in this regulation an obligation to map the critical raw material potential of extractive waste and to make that data available so that businesses can then make a business case for recovering that in critical raw material potential on the surface. We have provisions about identifying which products contain neodymium and other permanent magnets as a prelude to pushing for the recovery and recycling and minimum recycle content of future magnets. We will have the possibility, including in our strategic projects, of recognizing schemes that provide assurance that things are done to high environmental social standards. And we reserve the right to develop an environmental footprint requirement on certain raw materials in a way that allows you to compare the product that exists today, let's say magnesium produced in China with a footprint of 25 tons of CO2 per ton of metal, with something that can be done here, which may be done in a much cleaner way, but is more expensive. It's not a trade restrictive measure. It's information for companies. It's information for the downstream customer. But at this moment, it's just a shell framework provision, which we'll have to flesh out later. What I should also say, we're going to do a number of things which are not in our legislation, but which we announce in the communication. The first is, we're going to build in circularity from product design through the work on eco-design on products. We're going to come out with a proposal for the end of life of vehicles, which will prioritize the recovery of critical raw materials. We're going to come out with a collection scheme for waste electrical and electronic equipment. We're going to add battery wastes like lithium to the list of hazardous wastes annexed to the waste regulation. And we're going to introduce waste rules on the recovery of critical raw materials from wind turbines. So I think you can see we're really taking the circularity dimension extremely seriously. Finally, we're proposing to create a European Critical Raw Materials Board, where there'll be a place for every member state, observer role for the European Parliament, and where we'll plug in to specialized committees that will bring in the financial world, the business world, and other parties that we'll need to help us with all this. The communication, I'll just finish off, also has actions on skills. We're talking about creating a raw materials academy to create the skills base across the value chain, innovation, and on the permitting side, I've said here the regulatory side, but the human side is we're going to really need to have member states make sure that they have enough people to do the permitting and that these people have the necessary competences. So the skills and the capacity development to make sure that the permitting rules come to life is an important part of this. Thank you very much.
I'm going to give you a question.
Oh, okay.
So thank you so much, Peter. And I think we're all going to look very much into detail in your suggestion or the documents you've published now. But do you feel yourself that with this and the things you are plan to add, do you feel safe now that we are going to secure the supply for Europe? You said I was going to ask you a difficult one.
Yeah, but that was after I'd had a drink, right? look, hand on heart, who can tell whether we achieve the results that we set out to achieve here? The period to 2030 is relatively short. This piece of legislation will enter into force, we hope, by the middle of next year. So it's tight. But I think in the real world, we can see that things are getting a little bit unstable, a little bit unpredictable, and that all parts of the world, including the European Union, have to start taking much more responsibility for our own economies and for our own security. And looking after the security of supply of the critical raw materials we need is going to be an important part of that. So we have to do our best, and we have to win over society to make sure that they're with us, and we're not just pushing this thing through top down, we know best.
Mm. We're not doing this for fun. Mm. So being here in Sweden, we have people going to talk from Finland and from Germany as well. What do you consider the most important things that the member states can do to help this happen? What's the biggest challenge for the member states? Maybe I should put it like that.
Well, I think member states as political authorities really have the responsibility of making the case for action to their public. And that means action by the politicians at the national level, but also at the levels which are closer to the communities and the regions and the local authorities. Everyone needs to kind of move onto the same page and draw out, draw attention to the fact that you can't have your cake and eat it. You can't have climate neutrality without understanding that it has real-world consequences in terms of doing more for yourself and switching away from fossil fuels to things which are more metals intensive. You can't just say, we'll have that solution and we won't make an effort ourselves. We'll just put the burden on the rest of the world. So I think there needs to be some really good explanation of how complex this is and how we have to take more responsibility right down to the level of individual consumers and communities.
Thank you so much. I think there is time for one question from the audience. Yeah, over there.
Thank you very much for an interesting presentation. My name is Nina Kronier. I'm the Director General of the Swedish Radiation Safety Authority and a member of IVA. My question goes to, does this directive, the proposal for the directive or regulation include raw materials used for nuclear fuel? And if so, is it part of the 16 particular critical ones that you mentioned in your presentation? Thank you very much.
The answer is no. The definition of raw materials that we are using is non-energy, non-agricultural raw materials, right? So not in this piece of legislation. However, yesterday, the Commission also adopted its proposal for net zero industry, which is about pushing a lot of clean energies. And after a little bit of internal discussion, there's a certain amount of nuclear in there, particularly the small modular reactors, which means that in a value chain approach, the security of supply of the nuclear materials is also part of the European agenda. But it's also in my unit. But I try to keep my head around the non-nuclear stuff at the moment.
Thank you so much, Peter. And I guess you'll be around today for people to talk to you, as well as the people leading the different parts of the project. You will be able to talk to them as well.
Yeah.
So a big hand to you, and thanks for all your work.
Thanks, Erica.
And now I think we're going to have someone with us online. Matti, are you there? Yeah, there
yes.
You are.
Yes, I'm here. Hopefully you can hear me well.
Yeah, we can hear you. Good to see you. And I'm so happy you could join us online. So you're the CEO of the Finnish mineral group, of course, in Finland. And I give the word to you. Please give us your side of the story.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thanks for having me there. It's a pleasure to speak to you today, and obviously it's a great honor to speak right after Peter Handley, as obviously this is a big day for Europe, as the Critical Raw Materials Act was announced yesterday evening, basically. And sorry for not being able to be there with you. I have a quite a tight schedule today and parallel commitments here in Helsinki. So I hope that this works out fine this way, and I hope that you can see the slides that I'm about to show you. So I know that or assume that basically all of you are well aware, and obviously especially after Peter's presentation, well aware with the challenges that we are facing. But still, I cannot help myself a little bit kind of like addressing that as well. And then I will briefly explain that what we are doing in order to supply responsible raw materials and intermediates to the European battery value chain. As a starting point, and I will keep this brief, don't worry. So as a starting point, I like this example. So the starting point is that until today, we have excavated 700 million tons of copper throughout our history. So it's this kind of like a cube of copper with the edge of 430 meters, and then obviously it's a great achievement as such. But now that we go forward, what we need to do is that we need to produce that same amount of copper in just within next 20 years. And I think that this estimate doesn't even fully recognize the green transition and its demands that it's having to the copper demand. So basically we are facing extremely heavy challenge here. This means that we need to open 60 new large copper mines with a very fast schedule globally. And obviously, it's a big challenge. The reason why copper is here used as an example is that there is a good historical data on that. But obviously, if we used, for example, lithium or cobalt, I'm sure that this example would be even more drastic. And obviously, this same story continues basically with other products related to battery value chain, so that we are missing, especially in Europe, we are missing a lot of capacity when it comes to not only to raw materials production, but the production of intermediates, especially for example in this picture, anode materials, I guess that it's good to highlight that the European Union consumes 20% of world's raw materials on annual scale and produces itself only 2%. So consumes 20%, produces 2%. So quite a massive discrepancy there. And I think that it was quite well put from Jeff Curry from Goldman Sachs, saying that we are facing molecular crisis. We are out of basically everything, and I think that this has been a good wake up call. And for example, European Commission has been excellent in its work to tackle this challenge that we are now facing. And I believe that the mining industry really has a lot to offer here. So if we think about this, let's say, big scale global challenges that we are facing, obviously climate change mitigation is our key responsibility as a humankind, and then mining industry and obviously battery value chain on top of that are in the core of that mission that we have. Also today, mining industry and production of raw materials and security of supply chains is in the core of Europe's strategic autonomy. We have seen what has happened with the energy supply from Russia, and obviously no one wants to be in the same position when it comes to raw materials and their supply as we go forward. So extremely important important mission for mining industry here as well. And then finally, obviously, the, let's say, more traditional one, economic growth and job creation, obviously, key thing for mining industry to tackle. Before going to the let's say Finnish perspective, there is one aspect that I would like to bring up in this occasion, which perhaps doesn't fit my presentation so logically here, but still what I want to bring up is traceability. So now that we recognize that how important mining industry and these value chains, that how important those are, I think that one of the let's say driving forces here that are changing the industry is traceability and the actual tools that how the end customers can follow the trail of different raw materials and how they can ultimately base their own consumption decisions on the let's say values, that how they value the origin of raw materials and the value chains. So, for example, so that what is the CO2 footprint of the raw materials and what kind of ESG questions are related to the production of the raw materials. And I think that this is something that still today the industry doesn't fully perhaps recognize that how big kind of like a game changer this can be, because this obviously as we go forward introduces like a new kind of direct relationship between mining companies and consumers, and this is something that I'm really looking forward to, that how this will change the industry and even the business models. And this is perhaps a good kind of like lead to the next slide, which discuss that what Finnish Minerals Group and Finland can do and offer here. So obviously, on a European scale, Finland as well as Sweden are significant mining countries, and surely there is a lot of additional potential that can be utilized here. We as a company, so for those of you who do not know us that well, we are fully owned by the Finnish government, and we act as a kind of like a holding and development company within Finnish mining industry. So we are currently involved in three mining projects in Finland. Terrafame is the largest one. It is the only one out of these three which is operational today and has already long history. Terrafame is the largest nickel mine in Europe and produces also cobalt. We are currently ramping up battery chemicals production, so we are increasing the value add there instead of producing lower value products. We are now heading to battery chemicals production with Terrafame, and many of you who know Finland better might know that this mine has quite a let's say difficult history, and I think that it's a great example how good production and good care of environment go hand in hand, what we have achieved there. And today, Terrafame basically has the lowest CO2 footprint in the whole nickel industry, which is obviously a very valuable thing to have. We are also taking forward the Keliber lithium project. The construction has started. Keliber will be the first integrated lithium production in Europe, and start production 2025. And then as a third project, we have Sokli, which is a phosphate and rare earth elements project and has very large scale, and something that we clearly see that would, for example, now fulfill the criteria of this European strategic raw material project that was introduced in this Critical Raw Materials Act. So we are very very we have very very let's say positive view that Nordics can introduce new projects and strongly contribute to the European raw material need and battery value chain as well. So the other half, and this is my last slide. So the other half of our operation is the battery value chain and facilitation of this Finnish battery value chain. Here we have announced four projects. So we are involved in a precursor production project, cathode active material production project, also LFP cathode material project and anode project. So a lot of let's say greenfield projects going forward, we see that based on these projects based on the BASF production in Finland, based on Umicore production in Finland and so forth, Finland is becoming, let's say, kind of like a hub for intermediates production in Europe. So this is perhaps a good time to finalize the presentation leave some room for any questions if there might be.
Thank you so much, Matti. So this is an impressive portfolio that you presented to us, and I know it doesn't come without challenges, but looking forward, what do you think the major challenges for EU member states and companies within EU are when it comes to increasing the production of raw materials on the internal market? Is it, if you look at it in terms of legislations, public conception on mining, that kind of things?
Yeah, I think that the answer really depends that are we talking about mining itself or are we talking about different projects along the value chain. When it comes to mining, then obviously we are kind of like restricted with the actual ore reserves and how the exploration goes forward. So that is obviously a little bit limiting factor as such. But for mining projects, it is clear that permitting is causing delays. For example, this Sokli project that we have, it has been studied already for 55 years, and we are still in the early phases of its development. So that is the challenge that we have here, that the development of mining projects is extremely slow, and that is something that we should obviously understand well, that now that the need for raw materials is increasing rapidly, the industry really has challenges to grow its production at a similar pace.
And you got a new mining act in Finland recently.
Yeah.
Do you think it will play together with the new suggestions from the Commission?
Well, this Mining Act becomes effective next summer, I believe, and it has been quite a long preparation. There are really a lot of different views when it comes to mining, so that it's a kind of like a balance of different type of approaches and opinions. As such, we don't see that it should affect the industry that much. It might cause challenges to some individual projects, but basically I think that it's on the other hand good that the overall public view on mining is supported on like refreshed legislation. And for example, there will be now mining tax in Finland as well, which is relatively small in its quantity, but hopefully also something that helps the industry to enhance its social license to operate.
Thank you so much, Matti, for taking time for us. And I hope we'll see you maybe in person next time. So thank you again for all your insights.
Thank you.
And now we're moving from Finland to Germany. And I would like to welcome Peter Buchholz on stage. You're the CEO of DERA, Deutsche Rohstoffagentur. I didn't take German in school, but I try. So you've been with BGR since 2005. You are an economic geologist, and you have long experience with research, exploration, and commodity trading even. So the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Thank you for the invitation to this very historic day. The Raw Materials Act is out, and never in Europe's history, the raw materials topic has reached such a high political level. Germany has some experience with some points in this act, but not with all of them. That will be a great challenge for all the member states to administratively handle all these new regulations. For example, Germany has no stockpiling program except for oil. And there's a lot of thought now going into everybody, governments, to look into it and see how and what can be done exactly. So I want to give you a little bit background of what we have done through activities in the German government, through the German Mineral Resources Agency, which is part of the German Geological Survey, in the past 10 years. DERA is part of the German Geological Survey, Federal Institute for Geoscience and Natural Resources. We are subordinate to the Federal Ministry of Economics and Climate Action, and we are also integral part of the German Raw Materials Strategy. And the major aim is to advise the German industry regarding price and supply risks along the supply chain and to mitigate risks mainly by looking for new supply sources for diversification of supply. And I want to give you a little bit of insight of how we do this as an agency. The Act also mentioned that agency now asked to work together. And because of our long experience, we also want to share our experience with the member states. We have a good team, a well-experienced team, which is key to come up with high-quality information. We are 25 colleagues at the moment, geologists, economists, one mining engineer, metallurgist, IT specialist, and a bit of supporting staff to make the whole thing operational. We are based in Berlin, a branch of BGR located in Hanover. And this is just an organization scheme, but I want to just point to the three units that we have at DERA in red and green color. We have a mineral economics unit that is doing a raw materials monitoring and looking into risk assessment. We have a mineral resource evaluation unit looking at new projects all over the world for diversification purposes. And this is very new also to us and also to geological surveys, because normally with the recycling aspect is not covered in geological surveys, because we are geologists and geoscientists and not engineers that you need to look into recycling and circularity processes. So we have a new unit since 2021, because these are the two columns, mining and recycling, are the two flows for mineral supply. The next two charts are not shown on the video stream, but it shows that when DERA was formed in 2010, we had weak strategies in industry and politics for mineral raw materials and to counteract new challenges. Now, after the 10 years of DERA, the boom is back, basically. But we think, at least in Germany, industry and politics are much better prepared for all these new challenges that we're facing. These are just a couple of newspaper, magazine article front pages that were published last year and this year. So raw materials has come onto the floor, not only in politics, but also in public. So we face global challenges like the war in Ukraine, very high energy and raw material prices. The Minerals Act does not go into the high energy prices, which we will have lots of discussions on that. Price volatilities are still there and very high. Energy security and energy transition in Europe is a huge matter, rising inflation and interest rates, the euro weakness, recession concerns, skills shortages, and some additional EU headaches. But on the other hand, we have the China issue, China's changing supplier role is very, very important, looking at monitoring what is happening in China and their five-year plans. And there are lots of other problems, and these problems now face a high dependency of the EU regarding raw material imports. This map is showing the EU import dependence, and what you're seeing on the right-hand side is that certainly China dominates a lot of raw materials production, but also refining production and intermediates production. But not only China, but as Peter Handley already mentioned, there's a high market concentration in other countries, like in South Africa, or in Brazil, or in Turkey, or even in the United States. We'll have our colleague from the US speaking just now. So our task in the past 10 years was to monitor the raw material markets, plus to identify mitigation strategies. I want to talk mainly about the monitoring aspect. So we do screen many technologies that may have an impact to the raw material markets, about 200 technologies. Together with German Fraunhofer Institute, we also monitor the supply of potentially critical raw materials, and published this, I think it's the sixth edition already in the DERA criticality list. We do a price monitoring, over 80 price specifications, and where we identify price risks, we do risk assessments for specific raw materials. And I think the value of our work is that, you know, the studies are not left in the drawers. We talk actively with our industry and industry workshops about the situation and exchange our views. So we are more kind of a sparring partner to our industry. Right, this is a bit more on our monitoring process and the products, and the maximum space of monitoring is currently a monthly monitoring, but we think we need to become better by monitoring on a daily basis, much better daily basis. And just this will give you an example how effective monitoring can be. We had the magnesium crisis last year, 2021 in September, when the magnesium prices increased five times because of energy shortages in China. And because magnesium was on our criticality list, we did a risk assessment already in 2019. Our price monitor detected some price increases early 2021. So we looked into the matter, and we warned actually the industry 2 months ahead that there might be a problem for magnesium in China. So at least the industry has an advantage of 2 months to act before a potential crisis may come in place. So what we want to achieve in the next step, just a second. What we would like to achieve And the next step is that we want to use big data and artificial intelligence to monitor a lot of indicators which are shown here, natural occurrence indicators, transportation, social political indicators, events and incidents that may occur in the mining industry and the refining industry. And we also want to track suppliers in the world that are responsible for the production, mining and refining. And what you get is an alert system of the mines and refineries where you can see that an incident is actually happening. The difficult task of this is to rate whether that incident really has an impact, like a strike in Chile or Peru and many other incidents, whether that really has an impact to the supply chain. So that's part of our current research. Now, looking into, just to give you an example, to the screening of demand, there certainly are challenges by future technologies that influence the demand for raw materials. Now, this is just an example of 30 technologies that we think have an impact on demand. And from these 30 technologies, there certainly is the battery technology and many others. And the result of the studies that we do over now 15 years of screening is, you know all about that, that we do have a high increase in demand for lithium, for the rare earth elements, the light and heavy rare earth elements, for cobalt, etc., etc. I don't want to go into detail, but I find this chart very interesting because our monitoring of demand over the past 10, 12 years shows that in 2030, the first monitoring was done in 2009 with a scenario for 2030, and the next was done 5 years later with a demand scenario for 2035, and now the last one was done for 2040. And what you see in these yellow lines is that actually the demand changes with the development of technologies. So it's good to do this monitoring. The example is lithium. In 2009, we expected for the battery technologies just a very low demand increase of a couple of hundred tons. And then the demand increase already was 5 years later was 110,000. And for the last study and published in 2021, the demand already increased for that technology, for these technologies, to 380,000 tons. This is how to read this chart. But it shows that monitoring is very important, monitoring on a regular basis. And I'm happy to see that the EU is suggesting that a new observatory should be in place to monitor the future technologies, because we need such a support. Right, so all these risks in the supply, these risks in mining and refining industries, they pass through the whole supply chains. And I want to point to a new study that we subcontracted to PricewaterhouseCoopers on securing raw material supply, where we asked them to ask companies in outside Europe, or inside and outside Europe, but foreign countries, foreign companies, how they do this, how they secure their supply chain. And sort of to get a learning curve of what they are doing to help our own industry to improve their strategies. And what came out are 11 strategies that they are common knowledge, if you want, but it starts with commodity price hedging, ends with developing new business tools, but also increased recycling and so on, and stockpiling. But it was interesting to look at the rating of what they find effective of each of the strategies. And the most effective strategies from their point of view was supplier diversification and long-term contracts. And the least effective, they said, was the manufacturing industry was asked, by the way. The least effective, they said, was vertical integration. which is surprising because that's the most effective tool to secure supply sources. But it's, in a way, it's also logic. However, the industry was also asked how they would change their strategies in future, so their planned usage is shown here in the gray columns. And that shows that there's the biggest change will be to improve the forming purchasing groups, also into material substitution, material efficiency increases, also recycling, and developing or investing in developing new business tools like using big data and analytics and artificial intelligence analytics to track their supply chains. So we think that, well, they think, but we also think that using offtake agreements to diversify supply chains is very effective. But we also think that investments, direct investments into the supply chain are very effective, can be very effective, but companies don't really like to enter that field. There are German measures already to support offtake agreements on the international level, so-called untied loan guarantees given by the government. This shows a bit of the structure, but the idea is that the government provides a guarantee to banks to de-risk projects, similar to what Peter Handley was suggesting in the Raw Materials Act, and that a German manufacturer can actually supply raw materials from a new mining project that is de-risked with these government guarantees. So that's one tool. The better tool, or yeah, the even more effective tool, is that what JOGMEC does. They, JOGMEC and the South Korean government, they have invested together in CBMM, which is the biggest niobium producer in Brazil, and they have bought into a minority share just to secure their supply source, secure by government money, basically, secure an access to a very critical market, if you want, and to provide that access to the Japanese industry. Right, and I'm coming to the end, just showing you how the German industry was performing over the past 30-50 years regarding mitigation of supply risks. I'm coming to the end, so I'm seeing that time is value. In 1958, Germany was very active in securing iron ore in the Liberian Bong Range. They were forming the Deutsche Liberian Mining Company, the LIMCO, and the first shipments to ThyssenKrupp and others was 1965, almost 8 years after this activity. 1978, a couple of German companies formed the Kupfer Explorationsgesellschaft. They invested in the Oktedi copper mine in Papua New Guinea. And there was a link to the Norddeutsche Affinerie, which today is Aurubis. They had an offtake agreement with Oktedi, so the whole thing worked very well. In 2011, there was high activity by Siemens and others to use offtake agreements for a couple of rare earth deposits, for example, Linus Corporation. And I'm jumping over this one. And today, well, since between 1990 and 2020, there were lots of activities by international companies to use vertical integration into the mining sector, but also through the whole value chain from manufacturing and back to mining and exploration, like San Cristobal and Ambatovi for Sumitomo and others. Now today, there's more activity coming up, like by automotive companies. They are using offtake agreements back into the mining industry, and Volkswagen already announced this week that they also want to step into mining. So this is an outlook of what seems to be necessary, and let's see how things develop. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Peter. Yeah, we actually saw at PDAC now a lot of interest for vertical integration. So it's in there somehow. I think it's very impressive the work you do with the foresights. But do you see that it helps German companies to sufficiently de-risk their supply chains? Does it work? Do they use it? And will the new Raw Materials Act increase their opportunities?
A very short answer. Companies in Germany are highly aware of all those risks over the past years. They have implemented strategic groups to monitor these markets as well. So, but they are very reluctant to investment into the mining and refining stage because they still rely on offtakes, which is understandable, but we think it needs more engagement into the actually mining industry. So we hope the Act will also support these initiatives.
Thank you so much. So our next speaker is Rod Eggert, who is a professor of Colorado School of Mines, my dream university if I would do it again. And you're also deputy director of the Critical Materials Institute. And you're going to give us the American perspective on what's going on in the world now with raw material supply. Thank you so much.
Well, good morning, and thank you very much. It's both a pleasure and an honor to be with you. I think you indicated I'm going to provide the perspective from the United States. I would say rather it will be a perspective from the United States, and actually four perspectives. But I say a perspective for an important reason. I'm an academic. I'm a professor at Colorado School of Mines. I'm involved with a government-funded research and development activity, this thing called the Critical Materials Institute, which is a Department of Energy-funded consortium of universities, companies, and national laboratories, but I'm not here representing the U.S. government, just to be clear. So I have four perspectives to offer. The first, as others have said, demand for some metals and minerals will grow significantly over the next several decades. But exactly how much and how soon, we don't really know. We can peer out into the future, as Peter Buchholz just explained, but we have to adapt our expectations over time as things like technologies change. There was a very interesting study published a year or so ago by the International Energy Agency, which provides another foresight activity aimed at critical raw materials. Don't worry so much about the details of this slide. We have basically a horizontal axis, which is measured in terms of kilograms of material, and it compares for a selected set of materials that you see on the right, so copper for electrification, lithium, cobalt, nickel, manganese, graphite for battery materials, rare earths, and some other materials. And it compares in the transport sector, a conventional vehicle, in kilograms per vehicle with a typical electric vehicle. And the key point here is that for this set of materials, an electric vehicle is roughly, what, six times more intensive in terms of kilograms per vehicle than a conventional vehicle. So certain markets are going to be impacted significantly. They do a similar exercise for power generation. In this case, the horizontal axis, the units are kilograms per megawatt hour, and it compares coal and natural gas on the bottom with various emerging technologies. Nuclear is not so much emerging, but is under reconsideration. But we have solar, photovoltaic, onshore wind, and offshore wind. And again, significantly more intensive per kilowatt of power capacity. So point number one, demand is going to increase significantly. Second, it's about supply chains, not just mining. And other speakers referred to this. Here is the International Energy Agency's take on this. And so the horizontal axis in this case is not kilograms. Rather, it is the market share combined for the top three producing countries. And so at the extraction phase on the left, we see oil and natural gas on the top at roughly 40% world market share combined for the top three countries. And going to the bottom of the figure for copper, nickel, cobalt, rare earths, and lithium, in each case, more geographically concentrated. And we do the same thing, or they do the same thing at the processing stage. So the midstream, as some people call it, or think of it as smelting and refining, metal making, and alloy making. We have oil refining and liquefied natural gas for export at the top. It's roughly 40%, don't worry about the specific numbers. For the same set of minerals and materials, the geographic concentration of production is higher. So greater geographic concentration, which isn't necessarily bad, but clearly an important part of the story, which we haven't heard so much about yet this morning, but which I think is perhaps the driving force in discussions around this issue in the United States, is the role of China in many of these mineral and metal markets. And you see that on the right-hand side, a greater role for these materials in the midstream, in processing for producers in China. So that was my second point. It's about supply chains, not just mining. Third, what we're really talking about with strategic raw materials, to use the EU phrase, or critical minerals and materials, as they've become referred to in the United States, it's about risk. And I would just like to observe that we're really talking about several types of risk, and the risks in the short term, one to a few years, maybe up to a decade, are much, much different than the longer term risks. And by that, I mean, in the short term, it's lack of diversity in the supply chains that leads to the potential for surprise and disruption. But over the longer term, beyond a decade or so, it's lack of capacity, not so much lack of diversity. And I go on to say lack of capacity of the right type that leads to insufficient deployment of the clean or emerging energy technologies. And when I say of the right type, I'm really thinking about the reality that we would like over the longer term mineral and metal supplies that have five characteristics, five desirable, even necessary characteristics. We want supplies to be sufficient to meet our clean energy targets. We want them to be affordable because ultimately it's customers that are going to purchase the technologies, and we want them to be affordable. If not, the targets will not be met. We'd like them to be secure. This is the resilient supply chains desire. We want them to be sustainable in an environmental sense, and we want them to be responsible in more of a social, local community impact, community benefits sense. And we're pursuing all five of these simultaneously, and as with any activity that has multiple objectives, things are more complicated and more challenging the more objectives you have. And then my fourth perspective is it really relates to the broader context. The discussion and the public prominence of critical minerals and materials, I think, would not be as high, certainly in the United States, were it not for the broader context, this reconsideration of globalization and this reconsideration of industrial policy. And by industrial policy, I mean policy that is not sector agnostic. And if I think back over my professional lifetime, which is now 40 years or more, and I'm an economist, so I have been, my thinking has been framed about the benefits of greater globalization, the benefits of more sector agnostic or less sector prioritization in terms of public policy. But there's a massive reconsideration of both concepts, and I like the idea of a pendulum, and we're moving from right to left on this diagram, from a bias towards globalization and I say free market fundamentalism, but greater reliance on market solutions, a smaller, more constrained role for government, to one in which regions are of growing concern, or friends and allies are of growing concern, and industrial policy, policy focused on particular sectors of the economy, has become much more important. And we see this in headlines just from the last couple of months, in this case about industrial policy, the gospel of deglobalization, what's next for globalization, fragmented globalization, these headlines about industrial policy, why industrial policy is back, a tale of two industrial policies, how America and Europe can turn trade tensions into climate progress. So those are my four perspectives. If I may take just a minute or so to comment on things that have come up in the discussion so far. First, Peter Hanley talked about the EU, I think, list of 16 priority elements. The U.S. Department of Energy has 12 elements that it deems of particular importance. They call it the dynamic dozen. I think it's a play on, I think there was a movie several decades ago called The Dirty Dozen. Maybe I'm the only one who remembers that, but the dynamic dozen, and it focuses on materials for rare earth magnets, for batteries, for electrolyzers and fuel cells, and for semiconductors. And so it's things like neodymium for magnets, lithium, nickel, manganese, cobalt for batteries, iridium and platinum for fuel cells and electrolyzers, and gallium and germanium for semiconductors. Second, people have talked about the Inflation Reduction Act in the United States, and clearly this is a massive, important piece of industrial policy in the United States. It covers a lot more than simply raw materials, but a major portion of it focuses on climate-related initiatives. There are really three policy tools that it uses. Most importantly, tax incentives. Second of all, grants. And third, a significant increase in loans from the U.S. government for commercial activities. And it's really targeted at three in three areas. Incentives for customers to adopt clean energy technologies. Second, incentives for manufacturing in the United States. And third, and most controversially, particularly here in Europe, is domestic content and domestic manufacturing requirements. And finally, let me just observe that almost all of the incentives in the Inflation Reduction Act and other pieces of U.S. policy focus on the midstream. So it's the processing. There's actually very little to incentivize in the new policy mining in the United States because it has been the more controversial, and it's become impossible to reach agreement on things like permitting. So anyway, those are my four perspectives and a few additional thoughts. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Just a follow-up question. When we see in this mid-section, China is so dominant, are we going to see not the dirt dozen, but the dynamic duo with Europe and the US in the future? Is that what we... how do you see the dynamics develop between China, Europe, and the US and the rest of the world?
I hope that China and the U.S. and China and the U.S. and Europe don't become more antagonistic. Mm. That's just a hope and a desire. I would say that with respect to things like the Inflation Reduction Act, I think nevertheless there is a strong commitment within the United States and within the U.S. government to work with friends and allies. Witness the discussions, I think it was last week or maybe early this week, between President Biden and Commissioner von der Leyen, and a commitment announced earlier this week to work together to forge a U.S.-EU partnership with respect to raw materials and other initiatives aimed at encouraging supplies and parts of the supply chain in places like Africa and outside of China.
Thank you so much, Rod, for coming here and share all your insights. So now I would like to welcome our panel to the floor. So we have Ibrahim, and we have Anna. And Åsa, unfortunately, she couldn't come today, so we'll hope for her next time. And then we have Louise. There you are. And Maria. So now we are going to focus a little bit on the local challenges, on how Sweden can contribute to the secure supply of raw materials to Europe. And I would like each one of you to say a few sentences and maybe answering the question on what we can do when we have this global conflict between different objectives and we have the local situation where we need to actually do the things. So I would like to start with Louise.
Okay, thank you very much. And thanks to all the previous presentations. I think it's been exceptionally interesting for me to listen to. So for the non-Swedes, perhaps, I work for the Swedish Society for Nature Conservation, which is the largest environmental NGO in Sweden. So I appreciate, I think, Peter, you brought up really this complexity, and I would like to increase the complexity a little bit. I think it's very clear to us that we find ourselves in trying to tackle the climate challenge, and at the same time, we need to address the nature crisis, you know, where we have now converted 50% of our land areas to predominantly agriculture, where we have a natural extinction rate which has been exceeded 100 to 1,000 times, where something a million to eight out of 8 million species are threatened. So what I'm trying to say here is, whilst we're trying to fix the climate crisis, at the same time, we need to look at not aggravating at least the nature crisis. So whilst mines and metals are going to be critical for fixing the climate crisis, we must not do that and then aggravate the nature crisis. So I know this is increasing complexity, but I think this is critical for us to be successful.
Thank you so much, Louise. Maria, Svemin.
Yes, Svemin, the Association of Mining and Metal and Mineral Industry in Sweden, And of course, it has been very interesting presentations here earlier, and it's, this very much underlines what we are seeing from the mining sector in Sweden. The importance of raw materials and the value chains is increasing in importance globally, and Sweden has a unique position here. We know that in the Swedish bedrock we have many of these substances that Peter has on his list, both the strategic ones, but also the ones that are critical. And we have more substances as well that we need to develop our societies. But I'm very humbled for the challenges as well, because we know that there is always conflicts around how we should use the land. And the special feature of mining is, of course, that it's very geographically bound. You can't start a mine anywhere else than you actually find the resource. And that always creates discussions around how should we do this with a minimal impact on environment and the local and surrounding communities. But I think the Swedish mining sector has a good position. We are working very much with these issues. And as a short reply to Louise's concern here, we're also working a lot on biodiversity and on how we actually can enhance biodiversity within the vicinity of our operations, because we know that we will affect exactly in the point where we are, but we can also find ways of minimizing that impact and also compensating. So I think we have an interesting position here in Sweden with very good technology providers and resources and active mining companies that are willing to contribute to the Europe's need for critical and strategic raw materials.
Thank you, Maria. Anna, you have a lot of insight in, as a chair of GeoRange and previous work, you have a lot of insight in local communities and their experience of mining and so on. What would be your take on this?
I think that we need to do our homework with the global goals and adjust them to the local so that they do it in a respectful and sustainable way in with the locals. And you have to include more in those opposites conflicts or opposites interests than just maybe now we're talking a lot about, for example, rain herding, but there is so much more impact.
Yeah, and the farming, we should have had Åsa here, it would have been very valuable, but there are a lot of those interests that need to be taken into account. Ibrahim, you've been the Minister of Enterprise, and you, when you were Minister of Enterprise, I know you talked to a lot of people. You learned a lot about the whole landscape, the local and national landscape, and also reaching out internationally. What would be your take on this?
Well, I think that the short take on it is that I think it was Matti saying that Europe is today producing 2% and consuming 20%. The first take is obviously we have a moral obligation to do more, especially since I would, without going into detail, there is, I think, without any hesitation, those 2% are produced, extracted much more sustainable, not sustainable totally, but much more sustainable than the 90% that we are importing today to Europe. So obviously we need to take a responsibility, because I think everybody can see that the demand will increase. And I think as Europeans, as Swedes, with the conditions that we have here, I think we need to take our fair share, and in the Swedish case also, I think more than our fair share, because of what we need to do. And that's one. The other perspective that I have, I mean, unfortunately, and I'm listening to Professor Eggert, I think it's sad to see that what we have been seeing in form of cooperation, in form of globalization, free trade is now rolled back. As a person who have believed and still believe that I think the humankind will benefit, all of us will benefit in the long run by cooperating to see that this development is sad, but still, I mean, you have to be pragmatic. This is happening. Started, has been developed through the last decade during the pandemic. I was the Minister for Industry and Innovation and Business at the time and could see how the breakdown of the global value chains, the logistics in the world. And obviously this is something that we need to take into account and geopolitically also find solutions. Not because we want to isolate ourselves, but we need to take into account that that what we have been seeing since the 1990s won't work. So morally, we need to take responsibility for what we need to do. Sweden has very, very good conditions. Secondly, even if I love free trade, globalization, and cooperation, you need to see that things are happening that are going in the other direction. That needs also Europe needs to take that into account. And I think it's great that we are doing it.
Thank you. So now I prepared a couple of yes or no questions for you. So you're only allowed to say yes or no. So the first one is, will recycling be enough to mitigate the climate change and achieve the necessary energy transition? Yes or no? We start with Maria.
No.
Luis?
No.
Anna?
Nope.
Ibrahim?
Before, when I was a politician, I would never have answered a question like that. But now I'm a free man, so no.
Perfect.
Yeah.
So total agreement on that. So the other one is locally produced raw materials to prefer compared to imported raw materials? Yes or no? Maria again.
What do I say? I see my members sitting here. but I think I say no. We also believe in free trade and that we should work on both dimensions, both enhancing our internal production, but also continue to have a free trade agenda.
That was a long no.
Yeah, that was a long no.
Luis?
Well, Ibrahim, I used to be a researcher, and then you said, it depends, right? Now I'm also a free person. I would be inclined to say yes, actually. Mm?
And Anna?
That's a tough one. I know what people answer, so I follow them, and I say yes.
Yes. And Ibrahim?
No.
No. Okay. So
I'm wrong.
very good. So I also wanted to ask you, and now you can elaborate a little bit. So if we start with Anna, what do you consider the largest challenge in order to secure a sustainable supply for raw materials in Sweden and in Europe?
Yeah, everyone here, I think, is going to answer a permitting process, but I say something else. People. Hmm. Because in most mining, mining is in the most of the NSPA areas. And how do you produce something if you don't have people working there? Hmm. So states, EU must help with that because we need people to do the green transition.
And Ibrahim?
Well, without doubt, public acceptance. We have the conditions. We have the companies ready to invest. We have the know-how. We need more skilled people, but obviously we will also need the public acceptance, because when we are talking about permitting, we are talking about changing our frameworks, our way of governance. In democracies, you will always, in the long run, need the public acceptance. And I think that will be maybe the greatest challenge to increase the production to the level that we need.
And what do you think, Maria, about the largest challenge?
No, I would say actually it's the permitting procedures, because they are really an obstacle in developing new mines and new resources. But of course, I would agree that skills and acceptance are also extremely important. But I think also there is a misperception when it comes to the public acceptance, because if you look at the communities where you actually have mines, there is a great acceptance of the mines. I saw we had a representative here from Pajala, from Kaunis Iron. That is an extreme example where you have more than 90% or 95% even of the population very positive towards developing the mine. So I think there is a very vocal group that rejects mining, but we also have a big group of people that are actually understanding the need for that and seeing the positive effects of those kind of investments and developments.
62% in SU's latest
poll. I know that you made your poll, and that was also very, very interesting. So, but of course, you should have respect for the dimensions on how to make it more acceptable to have mines.
Luis, what do you think?
Safeguarding people and the environment. Mm. And that relates, of course, to the permits. And I think nobody wants extensive times to get permits. On the other hand, the reason why it sometimes takes time is because you really want to ensure that, of course, before you operate, you will do that in a safe way. Mm. So I think there is a bit of a risk also if we really focus on we need to push them and cap it, as was suggested now in the Critical Raw Materials Act. Mm. Of course, we should really speed it up, but it has to be safe.
I think the new act was also suggesting that no environmental laws should be sort of infringed. So it's just to make the procedures more smooth. I think it takes 10 times more documents and a lot longer time in Sweden than in Finland, and we're both member states, so I guess there is room for improvement here. Okay, so my other questions to you all is, what do you consider is the single most important measure for Sweden in order to secure supply? What do you think, Ibrahim?
Well, this is the... I mean, there's no way around it. We need more mines. With all due respect, I mean, when we are talking about the northern parts of Sweden, when a lot of the mines that we have today, I mean, it's not a densely populated area. I mean, 40% of the country's area, for 500,000 people, mostly at the coast. When we are talking about opening new mines in more densely populated area in southern Sweden, in Europe, then I think you have a bit more challenge. That's why I think we need also to work with the public acceptance. But I mean, there's no way coming around. We need more mines, and we need to create those conditions, both in the permitting, but also in the dialogue with our citizens. But in the long run, I think also, to be honest with you, I think that we need also to change our way of governing in a way that we haven't needed when things have been very sunny. But now with the climate change, with the geopolitical challenges, I think we need also to make a change in our governance. I think a lot of the decisions taken decentralized need to be centralized to get more do things faster, to be honest. Thank you.
What do you think, Anna?
We have great knowledge in Sweden about mining. We need to do more work with the SLO. But I think we have a great opportunity with our climate, with our tillgångar,
assets.
Yeah. So I think that's a great measure, only that.
Mm-hmm. And Luis?
Well, I would like to return back to the climate change and the climate crisis. I mean, we realize how urgent the situation is. We have 10, 15 years to change the way we produce energy. And obviously metals and minerals are going to be critical in that process.
On the other hand, we've seen a lot of graphs showing demand going up and up and up. And I appreciate that the last speaker also you mentioned, we actually don't, we're not quite sure about exactly what minerals, how and when, right? Something like that. And I think for now, we see that we realize we need to have more minerals and metals circulating in society. Eventually, and hopefully, we will have fixed the climate crisis. Where are we then? Well, then we are in a society when we can start mining and extracting from waste instead. So then it's a different kind of society. At that point in time, I think we need to sort of, we cannot take demand just for granted. We cannot expect it to continue to go up exponentially. That's not realistic. We need to remain and adopt our society within sustainability borders. And when we are there in 15 years' time, we need to be at a good point to do that. It means that we need to start building already now for systems which enable its extraction, a new type of extraction in 15 years' time. And also that we are in a point in time, because nature crisis, you cannot engineer. So you need to have good conditions in 15 years' time so that nature can restore itself. And that requires a lot of sort of proactive thinking here and now, looking into the future.
Maria, what do you say?
I sort of almost forgot the question you asked in the beginning.
So I will do it again. What do you consider is the single most important measure to secure a sustainable supply?
That Sweden can do. I think definitely we should continue to develop the resources we have and look into how we can contribute with a secure and sustainable supply to Europe and to the allies, if you talk about that terminology. But I also think Sweden has a unique position in continuing being in the innovation forefront of what is sustainable mining. We know today that we have a close cooperation within what we call the mining cluster, together with our big technology providers. The Swedish mines are often test beds for new technology, for automation, electrification, digitalization. And I think that is a very positive thing that Sweden has and that we should continue, because we know that we have world-leading companies. Epiroc and Sandvik, for example, they have more than 70% of the world market of the underground equipment worldwide. And this is a unique position that we actually can work on, showing how do we mine sustainably, how do we do it in a more efficient way and with a small environmental impact, and that this is something that we can be leading out in the world and see that this actually makes mining more sustainable in the future globally.
Thank you. Luis, is there something we forget in the whole context? Is there something we haven't seen, put our eyes on yet?
Yes, questioning demand. We need to have a sort of realistic picture of how much, because we know that there are limits to how much we can extract. We know that there is only so much metals and minerals. How should we prioritize? How much should we extract? How much can we extract from waste? When? And how do we prioritize that use? That's going to be essential.
So the forecast methods that have been presented here and that you have included also in the Critical Raw Materials Act will be very important forward. Okay, so now my last question, and I actually am going to give it to Ibrahim, because you were Minister of Industry for a few years, and you started a lot of very important things during your time as minister, and we have sort of gotten the results now. Last fall, we had a big report on permitting for mining and so on. What would be your advice, or what would you say? How can we speed this up now?
Well, I think I was actually mentioning it earlier. I think you're quite right. We took a lot of initiatives, but our way of doing things, our way of governance is that we make an inquiry, send it to a referral. Then the government works with the first draft, sending it to our experts in the judiciary, and then maybe a proposal to the parliament. The parliament obviously process that, and then maybe you have a law, and then it gets implemented. That is about normally about 5 years, maybe. Now we are in a situation we would need to do this much faster. I think what if there is things, and I'm talking about Sweden, if we have things that are strategically important, meeting certain crises, meeting other demands, I think we need to speed up these processes. I would propose, and there is such a proposal from my time as minister, to create a new office in the government who handles strategically important issues like mines that are really strategically important, like other initiatives that need to be taken and that need to be on ground much faster than we normally do things, because our whole system of governance is based on sunny days, I would say. And to be honest with you, there, unfortunately, even for an optimist like me, there is a few clouds in the sky these days. So we need to speed up things.
So now we need to agree on doing things for the weather. We need more sunny days.
We need, yeah.
More umbrellas.
But we need to prepare if the storms continue to come. That's my point.
So thank you so much to the panel. Great contribution. I think we're going to discuss this in length for more years to come. And thanks to the audience, and also to the audience online. I hope you could follow in a good way. I have learned a lot, and I keep learning every day.
And thanks to everyone. I have some presents for our speakers.
Yes.
I have an English version of a book that we have produced at IVA about Swedish innovations. That is really very important for you to read. But no, I'm joking. It is important, of course. For our American friend over here. Thank you so much.